whether they were right or wrong. And again, I pose the question, when you raise the issue of morality, if there is no supervisory being, then what do we base morality on? Is it based on who has the might at any given time? Who's in power? What is morality based on? If there is no order to the universe, and therefore some being, some force that ordered it, then who determines what is right and wrong, what is moral and immoral? You use very religious terms interchangeably while you attack the idea of a God. There is nothing immoral if there's nothing in charge, because everything becomes moral if, in fact, the species as we are is all there is. We'll determine, let's decide every 4 years what's moral. Most Republicans do, but I mean, let's do it in the sense of, let's just say, forget all of that. We'll decide morality based on every period of time, because there is nothing up there governing it anyway. And you don't have to burn in hell to understand that life has certain guiding posts that has been set there well beyond your own being. And I think to think that the whole world was waiting on one's birth, your birth or mine, or death to set the framework of morality, I think that is very arrogant. It's also delusional, but it is very arrogant at best.
Again, in reverse order.
Don't look for help from the referee. I'm over here.
I incline in your direction, sir. Said it before. Very suggestive thing that you just said. If there was no one in charge, how would we know how to act morally? And this is indeed, this is a very profound observation. It's said in, it's argued by Smerdyakov in The Brothers Karamazov. He said, without God, anything is permissible. Some people believe that. Some people believe that without the fear of divine total surveillance and supervision, everyone would do exactly as they wished, and we would all be wolves to each other. I think there's an enormous amount of evidence that that's not the case, that morality is innate in us, that solidarity is part of our self-interest in society as well as our own interest, and very much to the argue the contrary, that when you see something otherwise surprising to you, such as a good person acting in a wicked manner, it's very often because they believe they're under divine orders to do so. Stephen Weinberg puts it very well. He says, left to themselves, evil people will do evil things and good people will try and do good things. If you want a good person to do a wicked thing, that takes religion. For example, I simply do not believe that my Palestinian friends, I've known for years, think that to blow yourself up outside an orphanage is a moral act, or inside one is a moral act, or in an old people's home in Netanya is a moral action, that anything in their nature makes them think this. But their mullahs tell them that it is, and that the person doing this is a hero. I do not think that any person looking at a newborn baby would think, how wonderful, what a gift, but now just let's start sawing away at its genitalia with a sharp stone. Who would give them that idea if not the godly? And what kind of argument from design is this? Babies are not born beautiful, they're born ugly, they need to be sawn a bit because the handiwork of God is such garbage. Well, honestly, this is what I mean when I say that those who think there's any connection between ethics and religion have all their work still ahead of them, and after thousands of years, still have it all ahead of them more and more. There.
So you do not believe in your long and thorough research of history that atheists ever did anything evil? These were only religious people that were driven by somebody representing God that made them do that. And people that came in satanic ways, all of that is rubbish. Only religious people reading scriptures of some sort have done wicked things in the history of the world.
I should have raised that question myself, and I realize also...
But you didn't, so I did, so let's...
I've never yet been at one of these meetings where it didn't come up, but I owe you yet another answer. When you say you've had this confirming emotion in your own life, of course, I would not be so presumptuous as to challenge you. Indeed, I believe people when they say that they have experienced miracles. I believe that they think that they have. I think I'm obliged to credit them if it comes to that, as long as they keep it to, if you like, if I can put it like this, modestly as I dare, to themselves. If I believe that I was saved because once a baby boy was born and before mutilated, was made the extraordinary discovery that he'd escaped the female birth canal. His mother was a virgin, or at least her birth canal was only one way. That thus I was a sorry thing, by the way, religion's distaste for these regions, don't you find? And something to put you on your guard. Suppose I thought, okay, now I know that, that must prove his teachings are true, which it doesn't seem to me that they do, but suppose I did, and I'm going to be saved by it. I think that was a wonderful secret. It made me happy. It should make me happy. It doesn't make people happy. They can't be happy till I believe it too. My children must be taught this stuff. No, sir, no, ma'am, no day, no way, no shape, no form. You keep your illusion private. And I hope it does make you happy, and there's perhaps some reason why it would. But then we're told, no, we're told with the Pope's authority to say you can't have a condom comes from his ability to certify a miracle, a disturbance in the natural order. I think it was David Hume who put it slightly vulgarly. This was again about the virgin birth, I think. Which is more likely, that the whole natural order is suspended, or that a Jewish minx should tell a lie? There has to be an answer to this kind of question. As to the secular bad behavior, well, I used to be a believing Marxist, and I've had this argument about communism in different forms of all my life, and I realize it's a very, you confront me with an intensely serious question, and though actually secular criminality on the political level wasn't really possible until pretty much the late 18th century, because the religious monopoly on violence and cruelty and torture and slavery and so on was so intense. It has to be said that some of my non-believing forebears seized the opportunity to behave the same way. Sure, there's no question about it. And I'll put it like this, to take the best known case. Up until 1917, the Tsar of Russia was not just the absolute ruler and owner of all of Russia and all the Russian people and everything in it, but he was also the head of the Russian Orthodox Church. He was considered by the church and the people to be something a little more than divine. Excuse me, a little more than human. Not as high as Hirohito, but a bit higher than the Pope in secular and temporal power. If you were Stalin, you'd be crazy if you didn't take advantage of a people who had centuries of indoctrination of that kind. Of course you would want to see if you couldn't replicate that, and to see about reproducing it, emulating it, trading on it, taking advantage of it. You'd be nuts if you didn't do it. So the answer, I think, which is a very long process, will be a long cultural process, is to try and move people up to a cultural and intellectual level where they are above that kind of appeal, where they're not credulous, where they don't take things on faith, where they don't make gods or idols or images out of anybody, including fellow human beings, and they learn the pleasures of thinking for themselves. How about that for a modest proposal?
I'd like to use my referee's power to ask you each a question before we open it to the audience for questions. And Christopher, my question for you, taking up the cudgels a little bit for Reverend Sharpton, you keep coming back to various forms of biblical literalism. Reverend, somewhat to my surprise, has not defended anything in the Bible and asks quite reasonably, what is your problem with deism? You've written about Paine, Jefferson, you write in your book about Einstein and Darwin, who are arguably deists in a way. What is, since you say yourself you can't prove God doesn't exist, what is your problem with faith divorced from religious text or literalism?
Well, religion is not the belief that there is a God, after all. Religion is the belief that God tells you what to do. So, if we have to talk about religion, we are not... A theism believes in the existence of a creating being, but it has no prescriptions for morality. You can't, as a theist, cannot say, I think that this universe is so well designed that it implies a creator, therefore, don't be going to bed with another member of the same sex.